Good evening and welcome to IPA 50 webinar series, New Horizons in Physics. As you all know, this series is held to commemorate 50 years of Indian Physics Association, which was founded in 1970. Today we have seventh lecture of the series and it will be given by Dr. Srinivas Krishna Gopal, who brings a different facet to rather technology angle to the talks which we have been listening. He's going to tell us about the accelerators at Xtreme. And to introduce today's speaker and conduct today's lecture, I would like to invite Dr. Rajini Pandey. Dr. Rajini Pandey is working at BARC. She is actually from ARACAT Training School, and she has done her PhD in the field of accelerator physics, and her current research interest includes study of space charge effects in high intensity accelerators. So I request Dr. Rajini to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Srinivas Krishna Gopal.
Thank you, Professor Nalil, for the introduction. Good evening, everyone. I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to conduct today's lecture, which is on accelerators on at the Xtreme by Dr. Krishna Gopal. And it is my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Krishna Gopal. Dr. Srinivas Krishna Gopal completed his PhD in accelerator physics from Cornell University in 1990, working on nonlinear beam dynamics in colliders. From 1990 to 92, he worked at the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory on free electron laser theory. This included a study of resonator stability and new concepts such as multi-cavity FEL. Krishna Gopal returned to India in 1993 and joined the Center for Advanced Technology. Initially, he worked on accelerator theory. Later, he took up the challenge of technology development and built up a group that has indigenously developed a plane wave transformer LINAC and undulators for the Qt FEL project and are working on photo injectors for short wavelength FELs. He moved to Bhabha Atomic Research Center in 2008 to work on the development of high-intensity proton accelerators for accelerator-driven reactor systems. His latest interest is in laser wake field acceleration. He was awarded the N.S. Satyamurthy Young Scientist Award of the Indian Physics Association in 1996. He was elected member of the National Academy of Sciences, Allahabad, India in 1998. And he was awarded the Outstanding Research Investigator Award of the Science Research Council of the Department of Atomic Energy in 2005. So I now invite Dr. Krishna Gopal to take over and present his talk.
Thank you, Rajini, for the kind introduction. And thanks to Vandana and the IPA for this opportunity to speak to you on the topic of accelerators. Let's see, Vandana, I should first share my screen. Okay, can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to talk about the topic says frontier accelerators at the Xtreme. It's essentially going to be talking about the frontiers of accelerators. This is roughly the outline of my talk. I'll give a very brief introduction to accelerators, not a very detailed one. And then talk about in succession, the energy frontier, the radiation frontier, the intensity, the medical and the accelerator frontier.
Krishna Gopal, sorry, your voice is slightly fading.
Okay. So let me start. So first of all, what is an accelerator? An accelerator is a device that increases the velocity of or energy of a beam of particles. And in our context, we are talking only about charged atomic or subatomic particles, which means this includes neutral particles such as might come from a nuclear reactor. What is a beam? A beam in accelerators has a very specific definition. It is a set of particles of the same type traveling together in the same direction and with around the same energy. So for example, you would not call cosmic rays beams because they can be of multiple types and may have a very large divergence in different directions. And of course, there are only two ways you can accelerate charged particles with electrostatic fields or electromagnetic fields. Obviously, it is the electric field in the electromagnetic that does the acceleration. But the distinction is made because the types of accelerators you build and the principles of acceleration are very different between the two of them. But I won't go into the details of accelerators themselves. What's important for us is to look at what the beam is or what the beam does. And the beam can be characterized with many parameters. The first, of course, is the type of particle you have. You could have electrons, you could have protons, you could have ions. The other important characteristic is, of course, the energy of the beam. And beams vary from, in accelerators, vary from KeV to TeV, as in the LHC. The beam has a certain charge, typically picocoulombs or nanocoulombs, sometimes even larger than that. Since you're talking about charged particles that are moving, it makes sense to think in terms of a current rather than a charge. And so one often characterizes the beam intensity in terms of a current, which can vary from microamps or even nanoamps all the way up to kiloamperes for accelerators. These beams can have a pulse structure depending on the type of accelerator that you build. For example, whether it's a DC accelerator or electrostatic accelerator or an electromagnetic accelerator. And you have often the ability to vary the pulse structure because you require different pulse structures in different applications. The beam obviously has a size in all three dimensions, and the beam size is an important parameter to look at as you try to transport the beam through the accelerator. And finally, we define something called the beam emittance, which is nothing but the phase space area of the beam. So you have in principle three beam emittances in X, Y, and Z. And it's important to note that the beam charge and the beam emittance are invariants. So as a beam goes around an accelerator, typically its emittance and charge will not change. However, the beam size can and will change all around the accelerator because that is not an invariant. Okay, this is all I want to say about accelerators. I'm assuming that most other things about accelerators are well understood. A few more comments on basic stuff I will make as I go along the talk. So let's first talk about the energy frontier. The energy frontier is extremely well understood as it stands today. Everyone has heard of the LHC, the discovery of the Higgs particle. Fewer people, so, but certainly all physicists have heard of the lack of discovery of supersymmetry at the LHC. The success of the LHC has been tremendous in terms of the accelerator, in terms of being able to build, design, build, and operate such a large, expensive, and extremely complex accelerator. That's been a triumph. The question, of course, is that given the fact that we do not have, we have not seen supersymmetry at the LHC, what next? And really, the next accelerator, which means the next step in this energy frontier, has a few candidates. One is the so-called high luminosity LHC, which is basically to increase the luminosity, which is essentially a measure of the rate at which interactions take place at the LHC, which means a measure of the rate at which data is generated for high energy experimentalists to analyze. This is basically a committed future to the LHC and will go on till I believe 2027. The other new accelerators that are being proposed or thought about are the International Linear Collider, which will be a electron-positron linear collider using superconducting cavities. This is being proposed, has been for decades now proposed by an international community, but more recently is likely to be cited in Japan. Then the compact linear collider or CLIC at CERN, which is from CERN's point of view, it's one direction of its future beyond the LHC. Then there is a proposal from the Chinese for what is now rechristened the circular electron-positron collider, which as its name suggests, will be a circular collider much larger than the LHC, 80 kilometers in circumference compared to the 27 kilometers of the LHC. But the important point to note is that all these accelerators will cost multiple tens of billions of US dollars. So these are extremely expensive devices. And therefore the physics case for sending so much money needs to be very strong, especially in the present financial climate. I'm sure many of you have had discussions on what will happen in terms of either any one of these accelerators or other options. And my personal feeling is that it is likely that the decision on the next accelerator will have to wait for the culmination of run two of the LHC, the gathering of new data, and the potential sighting of new physics at the LHC. So I really don't have too much to say on the energy frontier. Let me move on to something I'm calling the radiation frontier. And this is basically a frontier in which you actually use an accelerator to produce a laser. And the reason you do that, because after all, lasers are ubiquitous, so why would you attempt to do that? The reason you do that is because you can produce, and we have produced, an extremely different and extremely powerful kind of laser. And I show here the first data from the world's first hard X-ray laser that became operational at SLAC, the Stanford Linear Accelerator Center, in April 2009, so over a decade ago now, as the culmination of a very strong effort by the Americans to build this laser, this accelerator and laser very quickly. So this laser produced at that time 20 gigawatts of power at 1.5 angstrom, 0.15 nanometers, with 50 femtosecond pulses. And the question you can ask is that why do you do this? But before I ask that question, let's answer the question, what is, first of all, a free electron laser? So a free electron laser is basically a classical laser that can produce intense, widely tunable, ultra-short pulses of coherent radiation coming from an electron beam. So this is very different from the radiation or the laser radiation that you get from that you conventionally have, what one might call conventional lasers, if that term is permitted, where of course the radiation is produced by transitions of electrons between energy levels. And those energy levels are of course fundamentally quantum in their nature. However, if you have an electron beam in an accelerator, because of the very large numbers of those particles of the order of 10 raised to 10, the description can be entirely classical. And any radiation any laser that is produced from this would obviously be deemed a classical laser. I will very briefly just sort of skim through the principle of operation of a free electron laser. I urge you to read these general articles on FELs if you really want more information on them. So the idea is that since this is a laser driven by an accelerator, one must have an accelerator. And in fact, what you see here I hope you can see my pointer, the cursor. But what you have over here is basically an accelerator that produces electrons. These electrons can be of any energy, starting from a few MeV up to a few GeV, as we will see shortly. These electrons then go through the second part of the free electron laser, which is the undulator. So the undulator is a magnetic device whose job is in essence to produce a sinusoidal magnetic field right at the center between these two rows of magnets, which is the path that the electron beam takes. So the electron is going down along this path, and when it goes into the undulator, it sees a magnetic field, it sees a V cross B force. And since the magnetic field is sinusoidal, the electron also starts oscillating sinusoidally. And as the electrons oscillates sinusoidally, it will obviously radiate. And as in a conventional laser, you can have, though not necessarily always, but you can typically have an optical resonator, two mirrors that form an optical cavity, so that the radiation that is produced from the electrons bounces back between these mirrors and remains trapped in the resonator. Very briefly, I will summarize the principle of operation. So basically the electrons undulate in the undulator and they emit what is obviously incoherent spontaneous emission. This is basically just Bremsstrahlung radiation. This radiation then acts back on the electrons. Remember that the electrons moving down the undulator are, as I said, MeV electrons typically, MeV and above electrons, and therefore they are relativistic. And they will therefore co-propagate with the radiation that they emit. And this allows the radiation that the electrons have emitted to act back on the electrons. And when this happens, then this radiation will bunch them at what is not LR but lambda R, the radiation wavelength. And therefore the electrons that were otherwise initially continuously spread out are now bunched at the radiation wavelength. And now when these bunched electrons radiate, then that radiation is going to be coherent because the phase difference between them is a multiple of 2 pi times, is a multiple of lambda R or 2 pi lambda R. You call it stimulated because this coherence was developed only as a consequence of the radiation acting on the electrons to bunch them. And that act itself is the stimulus for the coherent radiation. You can ask what is the wavelength of the radiation emitted? And this is the basic free electron laser equation. The radiation of the laser radiation that is emitted, lambda R, is lambda U, where lambda U is basically the wavelength of the undulator. The undulator, as I said, remember, produces a sinusoidal magnetic field. So this is the wavelength of that magnetic field. gamma is the usual relativistic factor of the electron, and BU is the magnetic field that the electron sees at the center of the undulator. M and C are the mass of the electron and the speed of light. So you can see that the wavelength of the radiation that's emitted depends on the energy of the electrons, the wavelength of the undulator, and the peak magnetic field. And just to give you a feel for numbers, if I take a macroscopic number like 5 centimeters for the wavelength of the undulator, which is typically what you can get of the order of centimeters if you use permanent magnets, which are macroscopic objects. And if I take a 10 MeV electron beam, which means gamma is 20, then I will get a wavelength of around 60 microns, which is in the far infrared. But if I took that same undulator, which has a wavelength of 5 centimeters, but I put a 1 GeV electron beam through it, then from this formula, you can see that the wavelength will turn out to be 6 nanometers, which is in the soft X-ray. So there is a huge variation in wavelength that can be obtained using this basic principle of the free electron laser. And through this equation, you can see many of the advantages of free electron lasers. A, they are widely tunable over a very wide range of wavelengths, as we've seen. And examples of working FEL facilities, you can actually continuously tune the radiation from, say, 3 to 50 microns or 150 to 250 microns, et cetera. Much more than you can do with conventional lasers, even in an OPA or OPO configuration. You can get ultra-short pulses because the laser pulse structure follows that of the electrons, and electron pulses are typically picosecond, that is standard, and the sub-picosecond pulses are also fairly easy to get for electrons. Thirdly, you can get high power because the lasing medium, in this case, the electron beam, cannot be broken down. Even today, the electron is a fundamental particle. And also the lasing medium in this case exits the interaction volume at the speed of light. Unlike, let us say, a gas laser where the lasing medium exits the interaction volume at the speed of sound. And finally, of course, as the earlier example showed, the same principle applies all the way from terahertz down to X-rays. So there's a huge uniformity of principle of the free electron laser. But what we are talking about is X-ray lasers. So why, first of all, would you want to build an X-ray laser? Especially because building a free electron laser is an expensive object, especially because of the accelerator. Well, we know that matter around us is made of atoms and molecules that are arranged in length scales of the order of nanometers. That's why X-ray diffraction is such a powerful tool, because X-rays have that wavelength. But atoms and molecules move, they are not static. And they move in time scales that are of the order of tens of femtoseconds. In other words, if we wanted to resolve the motion of atoms around us, in addition to just determining their structure, then we would require a tool that has a femtosecond time resolution. In particular, a tool that has a length scale of the order of nanometers. And therefore, basically, we need femtosecond X-rays if we are to be able to see the motion of atoms around us, if we are able to make movies with atoms. And I will actually show you a movie with atoms towards the end of this talk, towards the end of this section, actually. So the question then is, and this kind of tool hasn't existed before, and one can ask what kind of new science, just not physics, will this enable? The way you produce these three electron lasers is through a principle called self-amplified spontaneous emission, which is similar to ASC in conventional lasers. The idea basically is, compared to the free electron laser diagram I showed you earlier, you don't have mirrors. I told you that the whole essence of the fact was that electrons emit to produce radiations, and the radiation acts back on the electrons, providing a stimulus to them that bunches the electrons of the radiation wavelength, and then those electrons emit coherent radiation. If I have a very long undulator in which the electron beam and the radiation beam can co-propagate for a long time, then I actually give enough time for the radiation to act back on the electrons, bunch them completely, and then for the electrons to emit coherently. And you can see this in this lower plot, that if I have a long undulator, and these are typically of the order of tens of meters long, then initially I'll have spontaneous emission, then it will lead to a certain amount of energy modulation and bunching, and then the bunched electrons will start emitting, and then ultimately the radiation power will slowly build up and then saturate. So I get the entire lasing action in one sweep of an single electron bunch going through this so-called SASE undulator. And this is something that has been done. The first soft X-ray FEL in the world lased in 2005 now, lasing between 4 and 45 nanometers using an electron beam energy between 370 MeV to 1.25 GeV. The first hard X-ray FEL in the world lased in 2009 at 1.5 angstrom. Using a 14 GeV beam. And subsequently, there have been free electro hard X-ray FELs that have laced both in Japan and in Europe. And subsequently, FELs have been built in Italy and in China. So as you can see from these facilities around the world, there are a number of them now, and they're quite mature because they've been around for more than a few years. Most of them have been around for more than a few years now. So they're quite mature in terms of the science that they produce. And here is just a photograph, for example, of the flash X-ray field at Hamburg. And here is one of the LCLS FEL at Stanford, the former being the first soft X-ray FEL and this one being the first hard X-ray FEL. High energy physicists may remember this LCLS or this Stanford linear accelerator as being the site of the first slack linear collider, the SLC, the first linear collider. Okay, so what are the applications? Well, so you can imagine how good these applications can be because you now have a probe that is of the wavelength of nanometers, that is femtoseconds in duration, that is coherent, and that is actually very intense. So an ultra-fast laser like this can function like a camera, but a camera which has a resolution of the order of femtoseconds and can take instantaneous snapshots of chemical reactions with these femtosecond exposure times. And of course, you can build up a series of such instantaneous snapshots taken with varying intervals between the first and second beams to produce a film essentially of a reaction process, genuinely making an atom with a movie with atoms. And this is important because this would allow us to comprehend the precise mechanisms of X-ray reactions, how, for example, atoms and molecules move in the energy landscape, which will then have applications, can have applications to optoelectronics, photovoltaics, solar cells, and so on. Another application area is to warm dense matter. So you can see here in this plot of density versus temperature, the red circle essentially indicates the area of this plot that a free electron laser is able to access. And so you can actually look, you can use a free electron, X-ray free electron laser to probe all these phenomena, brown dwarfs, giant planets, ignition and so on and so forth. So there are interesting and exciting applications of basically trying to get certain stellar processes to work in the laboratory on Earth. I'm not going to go into too many details of these applications, just to point out that they are exciting. Here is one of the first applications. So here was a structure that was milled into a silicon nitride membrane, mechanically milled into a silicon nitride membrane. It's a very simple image of two persons looking at what I presume is the sun. And then here is the basically the diffracted image from this structure. As you can see, the image, while the image in principle has all the information that was in the original structure, there's nothing you can make out just from the pattern itself. But when you back convolute the pattern, reconstruct the image, in fact, they were able to exactly reproduce the milled image with diffraction limited resolution. And this was at a wavelength of 32 nanometers. So this was the first example of a very successful use of X-ray free electron laser. This was done at flash at a longer wavelength, 32 nanometers. And subsequently people have used these free electron lasers for many applications. I only want to highlight one of the more recent ones. And this is genuinely, as I said, a movie with atoms. This is published in Science in 2018. But basically, they have made what would be called the first molecular movie of one of nature's most widely used light sensors, which is basically retinol, which is something that is there in the eye. So I'm not going to read through this, but basically what he says is that you are able to see how when the retinal signal retinal is set off by a signal that pushes on the protein that is the retinal, it changes shape in a way that is different from what was imagined or what was speculated based on other sources and theoretical considerations. I'm now going to come out of my presentation and actually show you that movie. Okay, there is an audio to this movie which you can't hear, but it's not very exciting. It basically reiterates what was written in that slide. But the most important thing about this movie, because we have all seen a lot of these movies, basically molecular dynamics movies, and it looks like it's sort of run of the mill. But what's very important is that all the data on this comes from an experiment, not from a simulation. So obviously the actual moving of the atoms is a simulation, but the numbers that you get that are written over there are numbers that have been extracted from the XFEL experiment that was done at SLAC. And the precision with which you can see the orientation of the molecules and the moving of the molecules and so on is the important information that you get that is new and that was not in this particular case correctly simulated before. So this is an extremely exciting piece of research, only 2 years old at the moment. One would say year and a half if you take COVID lockdowns into account, and really shows for the first time the coming to fruition of an old promise of X-ray FELs that they would actually allow you to see molecules, atoms and molecules moving in real time. So this is an extremely exciting result. I'm going to stop the video now because this just goes on and on and it's not very exciting. What is exciting is what went on behind this. Okay, so let me come back to my presentation. Okay, so as far as accelerators are concerned, this is one of the most exciting things one could do, I think, is producing GEV accelerators of extremely high quality. So it's important to point out over here that these things don't happen simply. The optical part is very difficult, but that's not my field. What is also difficult over here is to produce electron beams of the extremely high quality. And in this case, by quality, I mean specifically the beam emittance. I remind you that I define the beam emittance as the area in phase space, as well as the extremely high charge or high intensity that you need to produce. So this has been a challenge which was overcome about, by developments over about a decade to be able to produce such extremely high quality beams that you can actually get lasing in the X-ray wavelengths. Okay, so let me move on now to what I call the intensity frontier. In some sense, this is more than just the intensity frontier. It's also in some sense an energy security frontier. And this is of specific interest to us in India because this is actually a direction of energy security that we work in and that for us is really part of our future. So we all know that the essence of a conventional nuclear reactor is a controlled fission chain reaction of either uranium-235 or plutonium-239. Which produces heat which makes steam, which drives the turbine. The chain reaction depends on having a surplus of neutrons to keep it going. And this of course is intrinsically dangerous. You do have rods that go in, moderator rods that go in and suck up the excess neutrons so that the chain reaction is kept under control. And one of the consistent worries, and in fact the worry that has captured the public imagination, especially in the decades of the 70s and 80s, far more so than it actually deserved to do, is of course the dangers of that reaction becoming uncontrolled. And these fears have of course been fed by accidents such as Three Mile Island and Chernobyl, and more recently Fukushima, though that was not really a reactor runaway accident, but have certainly fueled public concern over the future of nuclear power. There is a way to get around this problem, which is of course to have a subcritical core, which means have an amount of material that is not enough for a critical chain reaction. The trouble with that of course is then you're not producing power. The answer to that is to say that, well, can you not give excess neutrons from outside through a source that is under your control? So that if there is ever, for example, a tsunami and a power failure kind of event as in Fukushima, you could just stop that excess source of neutrons, then the core is intrinsically subcritical, it subsides, it doesn't explode, it doesn't create a dangerous incident. You can do that, and you can do that by using an accelerator to produce neutrons. Again, I won't spend time on exactly how you do that, but very simply you take an intense beam of protons, hit them on a very thick, dense target like lead, and then the spallation reaction that occurs within the lead will produce boil off essentially neutrons from the other side. And these neutrons, if this lead were basically a window on the reactor, these neutrons will enter the reactor core and will provide the excess neutrons you need to keep the reactor running. If there is an electrical failure, because an accelerator is an object that runs on electricity, it's after all accelerating particles through electric fields, the moment there's a power failure, the accelerator stops, the excess neutrons stop, the reactor stops. So it seems like a very simple idea, but it's an extremely difficult idea to implement for two reasons. So the accelerator requirement for ADS is considerable. It has to be highly reliable, because if you want to produce power, you're connecting to a grid. You don't want the kind of incident that happened in Bombay last week. You need extremely high beam power. I won't show you calculations, but you need beam currents of the order of tens of milliamperes. And for protons especially, typically these currents are of the order of tens or hundreds of microamperes. So you're talking about at least an order, if not two orders of magnitude increase in the current. You need to operate this in CW. That means it needs to operate continuously, again, for reasons having to do with the throughput that you get and the importance of not shocking the target, giving thermal shocks to the lead target that produces the neutrons. And a number of other things, especially I should emphasize minimum beam loss, because if I have a 1 GeV proton beam, and that's the kind of energy one needs for ADS. If I have a 1 GeV proton beam that is getting lost in the confines of the vacuum chamber of the accelerator, it will actually activate the surroundings, and that is obviously undesirable. So in some sense, the technologically most important and challenging part of an ADS scheme is the high intensity proton accelerator you need for this. And there are a number of countries around the world that are working on ADS concepts, have been for a long time since it was first proposed at CERN. To get this kind of, as a benchmark number, let's take 10 milliamperes. To produce a 10 milliampere beam of 1 GeV is something no one has done so far in the world. What has been the best that has been done, and I say this as a cautionary tale, the best that has been done is to attempt towards 10 milliamps in China and 2 milliamps in the United States at Fermilab. Now, both of them attempting to go CW at these currents. At Fermilab, when they attempted to go CW for at only 2 milliamps, they basically burnt a hole through the side of the accelerator, compromised the accelerator, and they have since withdrawn their goal of going CW and are sticking to a duty cycle of only 2%, 1/50th. Of a CW. The Chinese, being more ambitious, produced a 10 MeV accelerator and started going towards CW. And they actually reached around 90% duty cycle for a very short time. And when they had concerns that they would get into trouble, but when they pushed on, what they did was to completely damage the accelerator. Essentially, they lost control of the beam. The beam hit the sides of the accelerator, destroyed the front part of the accelerator called an RFQ, radio frequency quadrupole, which is basically made of copper. Vaporized copper moved on to the downstream sections of the accelerator, which were superconducting cavities, contaminated the superconducting cavities, and essentially the entire accelerator structures had to be jumped. This was actually about 4 years ago, and it took them 3 years to come back to the same stage. And the latest one has heard is that when they tried again to accelerate beam to CW in this accelerator, they radioactivated their surroundings. So it's a cautionary tale that producing a CW proton accelerator of 10 milliamperes, even at a low energy of 10 MeV or 10 MeV, is a non-trivial task. So doing it at 1 GeV is going to be a major challenge. Certainly this is something, this is a challenge we are taking up in India. And it's important for us because not only because of the energy production angle, but also from the point of view of breeding thorium. And I won't go into the details of why thorium breeding is important, but for these reasons, it's important to have this kind of 10 milliampere or tens of milliampere 1 GeV accelerator. Because of the challenges I just mentioned and the horrific experiences around the world, you obviously don't want to do this in one gigantic jump. You want to do this in steps. And this is, in fact, the broad roadmap we have in India for these things. We have the idea of having a normal conducting section and then having either 100 MeV or 200 MeV accelerator that will use certain structures called superconducting spoke cavities. And then finally, at some stage, going on into what are called superconducting elliptical cavities that will take the energy to 1 GeV, which you can then put into your reactor. You could also, at 200 MeV, put beam into a demo type of reactor, because that is actually 200 MeV is enough to produce enough neutrons that you can test the ADS concept, which incidentally, again, no one has done so far, though people are working on that seriously in Europe, and test the whole concept. However, the the high intensity frontier of protons is not useful just for ABS. It's also useful for other applications. One of them is of great interest to nuclear physicists, that is radioactive ion beams, producing radioactive ion beams, and studying these radioactive ion beams to understand nuclear physics better. And another application of great interest really for societal applications, especially for medicine, is to produce radioisotopes. So one way of producing radioisotopes is through reactors, which is how we do it in India at the moment. But another complementary way of doing it is to use accelerators. You essentially bombard protons on various kinds of targets, depending on the kind of isotope you want. And then you produce the isotopic species, which you can then separate and give to hospitals for their use. In fact, the major linear accelerator at Brookhaven Lab, which injects into their main accelerator, is 200 MeV LINAC, which is used as an injector only parasitically. Once it's finished its job of injecting, and while the AGS alternating gradient synchrotron is running, this LINAC is actually used to produce radioisotopes. And apparently, for certain radioisotopes, they produce with that single LINAC about 25% to 50% of the entire requirement of the United States for those particular isotopes. So basically, a high intensity proton accelerator of an intensity not really achieved before is extremely exciting for us, both from the point of view of ABS, which is ultimate energy security, most likely through the thorium route, but also for intermediate milestones at lower energies like 100 and 200 MeV for radioactive ion facilities or radioisotope production. And here is just a brief map, technology map, if you will, of the various technology areas that one needs to master for this HISPA technology, that is high intensity superconducting proton accelerator technology, and our status today. A lot of these achievements are predicated on things we have already started. So this ABS idea has been around for some time in India, and our aim has been to build basically a low energy 20 MeV front end to this as a trial for the entire project. And what we have achieved so far in India is basically producing a line, having an ion source that can produce 10 milliamperes proton beam, accelerated beam through a radio frequency quadrupole, which is one of the more critical components. In accelerators, especially proton accelerators, the low energy part is always more difficult to handle than the high energy part. As the beam becomes a more energetic and becomes, so to say, stiffer, it handles better. So we've actually built, designed, and successfully commissioned a 4 MeV, a 3 MeV, 4 meter long RFQ, and I won't go into those details, but it's really a nice piece of work. But these tell us that we are very comfortable with the normal conducting front end of such an accelerator. We've also developed ourselves extensive diagnostics to test these to measure these the beam characteristics, whether it is the beam size, the beam position, the beam profile, the beam transverse emittance, the beam longitudinal profile, and right now we are working on measuring the beam longitudinal emittance. All of that has been done in-house. We've also developed in-house in BRC in another group the RF electronics, basically the low-level RF systems that are needed to operate such an accelerator. And that will be needed even more so for superconducting accelerators. And these have all been successfully designed and developed in India. So this is another significant achievement. We've done other things as part of the Indian institutions and Fermilab collaboration. So Fermilab is also interested in a high intensity proton accelerator. As I mentioned, they have a front end up to 10 MeV that, at the moment up to 2 MeV, just the RFQ, but 2 milliamperes that they are working on. We are collaborating with them. Their application for high intensity proton beam is of course to produce neutrinos for the DUNE experiment. So while our ultimate goals are different, the object that we will use to get to those goals are exactly the same, high intensity proton accelerator. And as part of this collaboration, we have built the first cavities called the spoke resonator cavities. In the earlier roadmap I showed you, these are the ones that will take us all the way out to 200 MeV. And the two of these have been built. They have actually been built by, the cavity itself has been built by IUAC Delhi, and the cavity has been jacketed at BRC. This was sent to Fermilab, and in fact, Fermilab says that this is one of the best performing cavities in a string of 8 cavities that they have in a single cryo module that is right now, in fact, in the beamline to accelerate beam. We have also independently done the design of these spoke cavities ourselves. So we now know how to design and build spoke resonator cavities. We have also been working on solid state sources that will power these cavities, as well as on magnets that are necessary to control the beams that go through these accelerators. Both have been made in the context of this collaboration, have been supplied to Fermilab, installed, tested over there, and are operational over there right now. So we can say that solid state RF sources and magnets have been successfully designed and developed in India and are working. And then in cryogenics, we've worked on a whole host of things on a 2K cold boxes at 4.5K, working on large capacity turbo expanders, large capacity heat exchangers, and so on and so forth. So there is a substantial amount of cryogenics expertise that is there, and more of it is being built as we continue in our collaboration. So based on this kind of pedestal that we stand at, and of course we have quite a distance to go before we can be completely confident of building things, we actually have designed in some detail a 200 MeV LINAC for potentially being built at BRC's Vishakhapatnam campus, with the ultimate application of being both a front end to ADS, as well as a driver for a radioactive ion beam facility, and also to build to produce radioisotopes. So it would be a multipurpose LINAC that could serve not one but 3 applications, and also be futuristic in the sense of being able to push beyond 200 MeV to 1 GeV. And as one goes from 200 MeV to 1 GeV, as I showed in the roadmap, one needs to switch to elliptic cavities. One also needs to change the frequency, which means you have different types of RF sources. And all of these have also been addressed by our colleagues at RRCAT. And I'm not talking about it here in the context of this 200 MeV LINAC, but substantial progress has been made over there in building cavities, building RF sources, and test cryo modules, etc. That really one feels that has overall is putting us in a very strong situation in terms of understanding and mastering these technologies. Okay, so that's all I wanted to say about this so-called intensity frontier, which is also in some sense the energy security frontier. Let me now move to the medical frontier, and I'll try to speed up now. I'm running out of time. So as everyone knows, cancer is spreading faster around the world, and especially in the country. And there are various therapies that are used for this, such as chemotherapy and brachytherapy, but also teletherapy, which is basically using either radioactive ion sources or accelerators, electron or ion accelerators, for bombarding tumors and killing the tumors. Ion therapy is superior to photon therapy, which is gamma rays basically, because of its better localization and lower damage to the healthy tissue as compared to photon therapy. And heavier ions like carbon are better than protons because they have a higher radiobiological effectiveness. And that you can see in this graph. So this shows the relative dose that you get as a function of depth in water. And you use water because that is close enough to the human body. And you can see that photons tend to, if I want to go to a certain depth, in this case about 200 mm, you can see that photons deposit energy all over, and in fact peak early rather than late, whereas both protons and carbon have this advantage of having a Bragg peak, which means that most of the energy is deposited at a fixed depth, which is calculable. The carbon has a sharper, better localized Bragg peak than protons, though you may see a little bit of straggling after the Bragg peak for carbon compared to protons. So that's a little bit of a disadvantage. But this is a summary of the teletherapy or proton therapy machine, ion therapy machines around the world. And you can see that, this is teletherapy in general. So this includes radioactive ions. But you can see there are almost 100 proton machines in the world and 13 carbon machines. Carbon machines are much more expensive. So though they have substantial advantages, they also have substantial expenses. And so they are fewer in number, but still very useful for certain kinds of cancers. Here is a photograph of a typical such facility. But let me just skip over this quickly. Another advantage of carbon ions over protons is the higher linear energy transfer. Okay, so basically for there is more energy transferred, and therefore you can kill more malignant tissue. So that's very useful. So basically, however, as I pointed out in the previous graph, dose beyond the Bragg peak is greater for carbon, which can be a problem in some cases. So basically, depending on the sensitivity of the tumor and the surrounding normal tissue, both ions have advantages. And therefore, based on the location of the tumors and their severity, the physician might find it optimal to choose either protons or carbon ions for therapy, which means really the decision of what therapy you want to use is a completely local decision, one that has to be made by the physician for a particular patient, taking into account the particular type of cancer he has and the severity and the location of the tumor. And therefore, a multi-beam accelerator is something that can handle ions from proton to carbon and perhaps ions in between or beyond would be an optimal solution, both from the medical point of view as well as the accelerator point of view. And let me just go back here for a moment. So as you can see, out of these five proposed under construction facilities, one of these is a dual purpose proton carbon ion therapy machine. So it's still being constructed. And if you take under planning, two of them are dual purpose machines. So you can see there are no dual purpose machines in the world. And therefore this is really on the frontier of teletherapy or ion therapy in the world. And so we thought that it would be a good idea to think about designing such a facility. In fact, we've actually had a month or so back discussions with one of the doctors from Tata Memorial. And they are the ones who are pressing that not a multi-beam hadron therapy facility is really the facility of the future as far as they are concerned. So we are also working on producing or designing such a synchrotron-based multi-beam facility. It can accelerate protons from 70 to 250 MeV and carbon ions from 100 to 450 MeV. And while it may not be the first in the world, it will be certainly amongst the very few in the world if one works on it quickly and expeditiously. And here is a typical sketch of schematic of how such a facility would look like. Okay, so let me move on to my last section, which is to talk about the frontiers of accelerators themselves. I started out by telling you that there are two types of accelerators, those that accelerate using electrostatic fields and those that accelerate using electromagnetic fields. But these, especially the latter, the so-called RF accelerators have certain limitations. Conventional techniques rely on radio frequency electric fields that propagate inside metallic cavities. And these fields cannot increase beyond a certain point because A, material breakdown occurs, and B, you can get field emission from the walls of the cavity. And this typically in accelerators today limits the maximum field to 50 to 100 megavolts per meter. It's precisely because of these fields that you have such large accelerators. The LHC has a circumference of 27 kilometers. The SLAC LINAC, which is used for LCLS, has a length of 3 kilometers. But imagine that you had a plasma as a medium and you could somehow build a plasma-based accelerator. There would be great advantages because a plasma as a medium is free from breakdown since it's already broken down. So it can support very large gradients instead of megavolts per meter, maybe hundreds of gigavolts per meter. And with such a large gradient, you can obviously get acceleration over short distances, which means you would shrink the size and the cost of the accelerator significantly. And of course, the physical reason why plasmas can support these high gradients is the collective effect, collective oscillations in plasmas, plasma oscillations, which I'll talk about in a minute. But people have shown that plasma accelerators can deliver accelerator gradients up to or fields of up to 100 gigavolts per meter, which means 1,000 times, three orders of magnitude more than conventional accelerators, which in turn means that the 3 kilometer SLAC LINAC could be shrunk to something that's only 3 meters long. It would fit actually in a university. And a TEV collider like the LHC or the proposed ILC, instead of being tens of kilometers long, would be only tens of meters long. Which would fit into almost any national laboratory, except TIFR because they don't have enough space at the moment, at least in Bombay. Okay, so what is the principle of laser wake field accelerators? Well, you can draw an analogy with wakes in oceans. So you know that as a boat moves forward, it displaces water and that creates a wake, and the velocity of the wake is basically equal to the velocity of the boat. And the wake is basically waves in the water. And if surfers, and this is how surfers do it, if you can if you can position yourself at the right point in the wave, physicists might like to call it the right phase of the wave, then you can actually surf, which means you get accelerated. The similar things happen when you shoot a laser into a plasma. So if you shoot a laser into a plasma, you will displace the electrons. You will produce a plasma wave over there. This wave will move, and it will have a velocity of the wake will be basically the group velocity of the light. And if you could trap plasma electrons into this wake field at the right phase, then in fact, those fields can be of the order of tens or hundreds of gigavolt per meter. So you could apply a huge force on these electrons and accelerate them. Now, early experiments in this field and this was proposed in 1979, I think, by Tajima, Dawson and Tajima. So it's an old concept, but these experiments were done, mainly done in the 90s. And early experiments, for example, showed acceleration of particles. And you can see, however, here the electron spectrum is continuous. So in this case, you can see electrons have been accelerated all the way up to 200 MeV, which is a substantive energy. However, the spectrum is continuous, and that means the intensity of electrons at the highest energy is very small. And this is from our definition of a beam particles of the same type with much the same energy. This could not be called a beam of electrons. Nonetheless, this was an important experiment because it did show that the basic principle of plasma acceleration does work. In 2004, there was an important breakthrough, important enough that it featured on the cover of Nature in September 2004. Three independent groups showed acceleration of particles that were quasi-monoenergetic. In other words, the energy spectrum was not continuous. It was peaked, as you can see over here. And they were different experiments with different parameters in three different labs around the world. And they all operated in something called the bubble regime of laser wake field acceleration. And I'm going to briefly explain to you what the bubble regime is. So on the left over here, you can see the wake field I showed you earlier from a simple laser going through. Here is what happens when you have a very intense laser that has certain parameters matched to the plasma density. You can see here the electric fields look very different from over here. They don't have this periodic nature. In fact, they seem to be sort of concentrated over here. So, and you can see from the lower plot, which is a line out of the electric field at the center over here, that at this point, right over here, the electric field is very linear. Whereas over here, the electric field is basically just sinusoidal. So basically electrons accelerated at different transverse positions will all be accelerated to nearly the same energy. And this is what leads to this very low energy spread or quasi-monoenergetic beams. Why is it called the bubble regime? You can see this from this plot, which is essentially a complement of the earlier plot. Both are simulations we have done ourselves. But you can these are contours of charge density. So what you can see at the background here is the ambient plasma density. And then what you see over here, the yellow stuff is basically a concentration of electrons in the plasma. This is the case when the laser has gone through, and you can see that there is a periodic pattern to that. So there are fewer electrons here, more electrons over here. In the bubble regime, however, you can see, so what you have right here in the front is the laser itself. You have in most of the area, you have the ambient plasma density, but right over here, you can see a very high intensity of electrons. However, at the center over here, you can see essentially a cavity. You can see it's black, there are no electrons over there. So basically it's like a bubble. And what you see, the bright spot you see over here is basically electrons that are injected into the bubble. And as I showed in the earlier plot, the electric field inside the bubble is linear. So these electrons that have somehow been injected inside will see a linear field and will get accelerated. And the beauty of this scheme, this bubble scheme, is also that you can, instead of having to inject electrons from outside as you would have to do in this periodic plasma wave scheme, you can actually get self-injection of electrons. That is, electrons in the plasma itself get injected. Here, I'm just showing you a movie over here of this. So here you can see the laser traveling in front. So we are in a co-moving frame with the laser. And you can see how the electron density varies behind. Okay, so let me run this again. So you can see here electron bunch forming, right? And you can see with time how it is moving forward in the bubble. In other words, it is actually being accelerated. Remember, this is moving at the group, the wake is moving at the group velocity, and the electron beam can actually get a velocity that is larger than that in the plasma. And so you can actually see the electrons moving relative to the bubble itself. But what's important to see is that you have a well-defined beam over here. And it is this well-defined beam that you can see, that you saw earlier as being quasi-monochromatic. The problem, of course, is that quasi is not good enough. You really want monochromatic. And so there are many techniques that people talk about to improve the beam quality. For lack of time, I'm not going to go through this slide. But here is the latest. So in 2019, the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory group have shown acceleration of electrons to around 8 GeV using a petawatt laser. So here you can see basically what is the phase space of the electrons. This is position and this is divergence, which is essentially momentum. And you can see they have they can see electrons going up to about 7.8, well, maybe not in this one, but maybe here. So they claim they have gone up to 7.8 GeV with a charge of about 5 picocoulombs and up to 62 picocoulombs at 6 GeV, which is what you can see here, the more intense spots. So this is exciting, and it has a divergence of only 0.2 milliradians, which is very important. So this shows that you can now finally, and this is only last year, get very high quality beams. Well, I would not say very high, but reasonably high quality beams using this laser acceleration mechanism. And that's exciting. What can you do with that? Can you use laser plasma accelerators for high energy physics? Because I said that you could shrink a TeV scale accelerator in from tens of kilometers to tens of meters. Well, to do that, what people talk, it's going to be difficult to have a single long plasma. So here, for example, they don't mention it, but I think this was a 30 millimeter plasma or something like that, a few centimeters anyway. It's very difficult, you know, if I want to go from 8 GeV here to 8 TeV, then I need 1,000 times that, and you're not going to be able to successfully propagate the laser beam over such a long length. So the idea to do that people talk about for high energy physics is to basically have multiple stages of these modules, laser wake field acceleration modules of say 10 GeV each, out of which around 8 has already been achieved, and then stage them to get TeV energies, much like you already have many RF cavities in a conventional accelerator. But many challenges remain in transporting the electron beam from one stage to the next and positioning it correctly inside the plasma bubble inside the second stage. So many challenges remain. However, what is interesting is that people have shown acceleration to 8 GeV, and if you back off a little bit on the energy and talk only about few GeV, 1, 2, 3, 4 kind of GeV, then they have shown substantial charge, as it says over here, 62 picocoulomb and 6 GeV, and while they don't mention the pulse width, it's of the order of a few tens of femtoseconds. So in fact, there is, so if you don't look only at the high energy frontier, and you look at something else, which is something else we already talked about, X-ray FELs, it's very interesting to ask the question, can you use a laser plasma accelerator of a few GeV? In fact, you need something like 1 to 1.5 GeV for a soft X-ray FEL. Can you use a plasma accelerator for that? And there are many efforts on around the world. I'm not going to go into the details of that. Nobody has succeeded in building really a full-fledged electron laser yet. Though very interesting studies have been done by scattering radiation, by scattering lasers off of these electrons and producing backscattered short wavelength radiation into the gamma into the gamma ray regime. And these are now very compact sources because the accelerator is literally a centimeter long. These are very compact sources of these short wavelength radiations, albeit obviously at reduced intensity compared to a free electron laser. But this is another frontier as far as, in fact, it's a merging of two frontiers. The intensity frontier and the accelerator frontier and the radiation frontier, and maybe one of the most promising areas for research to actually build a soft X-ray FEL with the 1.5 GeV electron beam from a laser wake field accelerator, which would probably fit in a large hall, once again enabling us to produce these kinds of facilities in the university setup, as opposed to in very large national facilities as it is at the moment. Okay, so I've more than run out of time. So let me conclude by saying that there is more to accelerators than the LHC. Accelerators are being developed to push back the frontiers in a wide variety of fields. I've tried to give you a glimpse of some of them. In each frontier, the challenges for the accelerator physicist are different and exciting. And there are many things I have not talked about. One of the important things I have not talked about, even though this is actually for a physics audience, is the importance of the study of nonlinear dynamics in accelerators. Let me spend a moment on that. I told you that for ADS, you need very high intensity, but then you worry about beam loss because if beam is lost at 1 GeV, if protons are lost at 1 GeV, they can cause damage to the surroundings. Well, why would protons get lost in an accelerator? Because at such high intensities, the dynamics of the motion of the particles of the protons in that beam is fundamentally nonlinear because they see nonlinear electric fields coming from the self field, so the so-called space charge field of the beam. And it is this space charge field that is in part responsible for driving particles to large distances. For example, if these particles had chaotic trajectories, it's not difficult to understand why they could go to large distances. Those large distances would mean that these would hit the inner surface of the vacuum envelope that encloses any accelerator. They would then produce nuclear reactions in that material, typically for the stainless steel, and that is dangerous. So there's genuinely a huge scope for understanding nonlinear dynamics, either directly through the methods of nonlinear dynamics or using things like the Vlasov equation or Fokker-Planck equation, et cetera, to study just the dynamics of beams and accelerators. And finally, of course, XFELs, ADS, plasma-based accelerators, et cetera, once developed in India, will substantially alter the research landscape of the country. Our accelerator program is very nascent. But there are many frontiers that we can move on. And I think in large measure, especially over the last decade, substantial efforts have been put in labs such as RRCAT, DRC, VCC, IUAC, et cetera, to really understand a lot of the physics and engineering issues behind accelerators. And we are probably well placed to breach some, if not all, of these frontiers. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Krishna Gopal. This was a very interesting and very informative talk. And the talk is now open to questions. We can first take questions from the Zoom platform and then from the YouTube platform. So if anybody has questions from Zoom, they can ask directly. If not, then I'll...
Can I ask?
Sure, sir. So Dr. Amit Roy, please, sir, go ahead.
Srinivas, it's an excellent talk. Very well delivered and quite you have covered lots of areas. Thank you for that.
Thank you, Dr.
I have one question, which is that actually it's not a question, just to have a status update on your LEHIPA, the first phase of it. What exactly can you just tell in a little bit, elaborate how what have you got and where do you stand as far as the beam?
So in LEHIPA, we have accelerated beam through the RFQ to 3 MeV. We did in April 2019. We have accelerated basically up to around 3 milliamperes of beam with something like 80% transmission efficiency. We have measured the energy, the emittance, and so on of the beam. They are all in good agreement with simulations. We have an energy spread of 0.1 MeV and so on and so forth. The next step was to go to 10 MeV using drift tube Linac structures. So we received our last of our DTLs on 28th February 2020. So we had about 3 weeks to work on them before the lockdown. And then there was the lockdown. So we continued to work a little bit right through. So more recently, we are now basically getting ready. We are actually, in fact, almost completely installed the MeBT after the RFQ. We are getting immediately after that, we'll be aligning the drift tubes and then putting the drift tube in. The one thing that is pending is that we have the regulated high voltage power supply for the second klystron. So we have one klystron that powers the RFQ. We have a second one for two DTL tanks that will take us to 10 MeV. And the regulated power supply for that, which has been built by ECIL. They also were commissioning it in March and then had to stop because of the lockdown. Only since this week, they have resumed work on that. Last week, actually, they have resumed work on that. And that installation is going on. We are hoping that by December, we will converge to have all installation done and then start commissioning in January.
Okay. And we still had the plans for the putting it into the part that there was a react, some kind of test reactor was being planned at BRC. Are you planning to inject that 10 or 20 MeV into the test reactor?
No, that plan, that's right. So there is a small reactor facility right next to our building. And originally the plan was to allow for an underground tunnel that would go into the basement of that building, etc. But very early on, it was decided not to do that. So right now there is no, you know, exit hole to take the beam into the next building.
If I may ask a little more, a slightly different question, can I go ahead, Dr. Mande?
Yeah, please.
I wanted to check the when you talked about the Longlian dynamics in this beam going through for high intensity beams, proton beams. Does it compare with the plasma in the tokamak also the nonlinear dynamics which gives the instability in the plasma?
Yeah, so there are two things. I think one of the problems one studies, of course, in high intensity beams, especially electron beams where you can go to much greater intensity, is this beam breakup instability. Which is, I think, similar to the kind of instabilities you see in plasmas, where the beam itself becomes unstable.
Yeah.
For proton machines, I think our greater interest is controlling the beam halos. So we always find in simulations that there are substantial beam halos, and in some experiments abroad, obviously, people have seen these halos. And as I mentioned in the Chinese case, where there was radioactivation of the surroundings, it was doubtless due to the halo. Probably not due to the beam hitting the chamber, because otherwise they would have melted the chamber, and that was not reported. Though it is China, maybe they didn't report it, I don't know. But anyway, certainly beam halos could be very dangerous in terms of radioactivation and so on. And there are these simple linear core halo models of how resonance transport can lead to the formation of halos. But we have done, in fact, we have a recent paper of about a year ago from a PhD student of mine, where we have shown that if you look at the halo particles, while it is true that some of those halo particles can be traced back to this simple linear coupling resonance, many of them cannot. And so there are nonlinear resonances that are driving particles to large distances.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
Can I ask a question? Yeah, hello. I'm Ajit Srivastava from Bhubaneswar, IUP Bhubaneswar. I have two minor questions actually. One thing is this, that about this plasma accelerator, will the electrons in the bubble regime emit Cherenkov radiation?
So the electrons in the bubble regime, in principle, do emit Cherenkov radiation. Some of those have actually been measured. There is a little bit of... So what happens over there is somewhat complicated, obviously. So there is some doubts about precisely what the mechanisms are of the radiation emitted, etc. Nonetheless, that radiation is measured. And in fact, there are some nice experiments done at RRCAT studying precisely these kinds of issues of radiation, basically radiation coming from the electrons as they oscillate inside the bubble. So yes, in fact, radiation has been detected from these things. Not very intense, but definitely radiation.
Okay, we can now take up questions from the YouTube platform. So we have a couple of comments from Dr. Kailash. So one of the comments, he says high energy alphas are supposed to be even better than the carbon ions. So would you like to say something?
So as I said, what the physicians would like is, in fact, indeed, everything from alphas. In fact, they've even talked about heavier atoms. I've forgotten, going up to neon or something. So yes, in fact, there is a whole spectrum. So from the medical point of view, one looks very carefully at the dose delivered inside the body as a consequence of this, especially the Bragg peak and so on and so forth. So there are some issues also about what damage heavier atoms do as they go through the body, even though by and large they are sort of, as I showed in that graph for carbon, there is the carbon will the carbon dose will extend a little beyond the Bragg peak, and this will be true of anything heavier than a proton. So it's really a careful optimization of the ion you would like to use for the particular application. But definitely alpha would be interesting along with carbon, proton, and other atoms. So as I said, in the table I showed of accelerators being built, there are two or three of these dual proton carbon machines. The interest in Tata Memorial is actually to have a multi-ion facility. That is not just carbon and proton, but things in between too. And of course, the accelerator can actually do that. It can handle the spectrum of ions.
Yeah. So he also mentions, this is another comment, he says that compact linear accelerators are also being developed for healthcare.
Yes, so I have not talked about most accelerators actually are built for, are used for, you know, what one might call societal applications. I have not talked about them, but that's absolutely true. Especially if you talk about linear accelerators, there are a lot of them are being developed for that. You can use them as compact neutron sources. There are many other applications which I have not talked about. Yes.
Yeah, so there is another question by Basavraj Kagali. He asks, can you determine the equation of state of nuclear matter using free electron laser beams?
Well, one would have to look at the, I showed that slide. Maybe I can go back and share my screen again. You really need to see where you are in the density temperature plot. And, okay, can you see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so if I go back to that, come on. Okay, so if you go back to this plot, basically this is the area that is typically accessible by this XFELs, right? So if you are looking at phenomena in that kind of density temperature regime, then I presume that you can do useful studies on equation of state, etc.
Yeah, so we have now another question by Dr. Datar. So he asks, have protons been accelerated using laser wake fields up to what energies and intensities?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question. I should mention that this is one important area I did not talk about, proton acceleration using lasers. I also did not talk about plasma wake field acceleration, which is basically accelerating shooting not a laser, but a particle beam into a plasma and then accelerating another particle beam behind it, or the front part of the same particle beam accelerates the back part. But since Dr. Datar asked about the first part, so proton acceleration has certainly been studied. And the way you do that is to bombard a laser on a solid target, typically foils. And then there are two or three mechanisms of acceleration. And people have seen acceleration of protons up to 50 to 100 MeV. However, the reason that is not so exciting at the moment is that it suffers from the same drawback that electron acceleration suffered in around 2004, which is that the energy spectrum is continuous, which means that though the energy extends out to 50 MeV, the number of protons at 50 MeV is very small. So if you wanted an actual proton beam at 50 MeV, which you could extract by energy analyzing the output beam from this plasma-based accelerator, the number of protons you would get at those energies would be very small, which is why there is still a lot of research that is going on. You typically need very, very energetic lasers. You typically need petawatt or multi-petawatt lasers for these kinds of experiments, which is why these experiments are not done in very many laboratories around the world.
Another question by Dr. Datar, can nano undulators be used to get gamma ray lasers?
In principle, yes. I really don't know if anybody has done anything in that. In principle, that's exactly right. If your undulator wavelength goes down for a given energy of the beam, then obviously your radiation wavelength goes down. There may be bigger issues in terms, there may be very practical issues in terms of the So the nano undulator has to be a very small nano structure, and then there may be issues of damage to the structure due to the beam that is going through. So it's something that one really would have to look into.
So a very interesting question by Dr. Vineet Kumar. He asks, in the very long run, do you think mankind can get rid of nuclear reactors and do everything with accelerators, which will be safe?
No, I do not envisage a future, at least in this country, where you cannot have nuclear, where you do not have nuclear reactors, unless nuclear fusion comes through. I'm only talking about the foreseeable future, and for me, I don't attempt to foresee the future for more than 20 years, because I don't expect to live beyond that. So in the next 20 years, no.
Okay. So another question from Rudraswamy Basavanna. He says, do we find linear accelerators in India run with heavy ions as projectiles? Any disadvantages in using heavy ions?
No, it depends on what you want to use it for. So of course, most of the DC accelerators in India do use heavy ions for research, and very successfully so. Both the major facilities, the BRCTFR facility at TFR, and the IUAC facility in Delhi use heavy ions all the time. It's a fairly standard thing in India, actually.
Yeah, so Neeraj Gupta, question by Neeraj Gupta. So he asked, for ADSs, will uranium or plutonium or thorium, which may be better targets than lead, any drawbacks?
I don't think you want to use uranium you want a very dense target, so lead, A. B, if you use any other target like uranium, plutonium, then you are going to have all kinds of nasty complications in terms of fission, etc., in the target itself. Whereas you would like your fission to take place in the reactor core that you've designed specifically for that need. So for both those reasons, I think you may not want to use thorium or uranium or plutonium as a window for an ADS reactor.
We have a question from G.S. Srinivasan. So he asks, in ADS, can you be assured of a constant neutron source from accelerator? Because fluctuations in neutron density can influence the stability and safety of reactor core.
Yeah, so this is an important point. Partly from the reactor, mainly from the target or the window, the shocking of the sort of periodic thermal shocking of the window leading to issues with the window itself, as well as in the power generation application of ADS, where you have connected your ADS system to a grid, you have very, very strong requirements on the reliability of the accelerator in terms of not fluctuating, not having fluctuations in the beam current or stoppages in the beam operation, etc. So this is in fact perhaps the most important open area. Well, I think there are two important open areas for ADS. One is the control of the beam halos, and the second is the reliability of the accelerator. Until these are solved, you cannot have an operating facility.
Yeah, so another question from Ajay Mishra. What is the prospect of building tabletop synchrotron machines using Wakefield acceleration principle?
So that is in fact one of the, I mentioned free electron lasers, but if you take half a step back, yes, people talk about building synchrotron sources using, the point is that you get a hundreds of MeV or few GeV kind of beam from a laser accelerator, laser wake field accelerator. And then with that beam, you can do whatever you have done with these beams earlier. So whether you're talking about a 1.2 GeV or 1 point something GeV beam for a synchrotron radiation source like Indus, or for a free electron laser, it's immaterial, you can do that. The thing you have to be careful about, and these things need to be calculated, is that in laser wake field accelerators, unlike conventional accelerators, the charges are also down by three orders of magnitude. The pulse widths are down by three orders of magnitude, because in conventional accelerators, especially circular ones, you will typically have pulse widths in picoseconds. Here you will have pulse widths in femtoseconds. But over there you have current charges in nanocoulombs, And here you have charges in picocoulombs, as I showed for the 8 GV acceleration experiment at Lawrence Berkeley lab. Now, if you looked at it in terms of currents, which is charge divided by pulse length or pulse width, then they are both in kiloamperes. So the currents are the same, but in terms of the number of electrons you have that radiate, so the actual charge is less. So you have to worry about whether your synchrotron will be adequately powerful or not. So it's a matter of calculation.
We have another question from Rakesh Kumar Soni. Which type of laser is used for accelerating electron beam?
Typically, they use, I think, NDAG lasers, Thai Sapphire lasers. And these are all, as I said, so the experiment I showed right at the end at Berkeley was 850 or so gigawatt, close to petawatt. But people have typically used even less powerful lasers, 100 gigawatt kind of lasers also. But the wavelength is typically Thai Sapphire.
Yeah, so with this, let me thank Dr. Krishna Gopal for the very interesting talk and for the very nice question answer session. And now I would like to hand over to Professor Nanal for concluding remarks.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Krishna Gopal, for a really wonderful talk covering wide variety of accelerators and their applications and really a lot of interesting information. There have been many appreciative comments on the YouTube also saying that it was very informative and a very interesting talk. Thank you, Dr. Rajini, for conducting the lecture so nicely. And thank you all participants from Zoom and YouTube for attending this lecture and being part of IPA 50. So we will have next Saturday lecture by Professor Antia, and he will take us to the interior of the sun of and about the seismic view of the solar interior. So I look forward to seeing you all next Saturday at 5 p.m. So stay safe, take care, bye-bye, and thank you.